thank you for joining my farewell concert at Hope Lutheran in Bozeman. It's very nice to play for you all. There's no particular theme to this concert. It's just a compendium of things that I've been working on recently and that I'm very excited to share with you. If you've enjoyed it and you are listening online, please feel free to make use of the virtual tip jar function on the Bozeman Arts Live site. And while I'm on that subject, a big, big thank you to Thomas. Thomas, I have worked with Thomas several times this spring, and he's done amazing work in keeping live music going through these strange times we found ourselves in. The first piece I'm going to play today is the first movement of Louis Vierne's Symphony No. 2. When I was not able to play in church regularly any longer, I found myself with some time on my hands. So I started working on various bits of big symphonic repertory that otherwise I might not have been able to have the time to practice. And this was one of them. The Symphony No. 2 was finished in 1903. Vierne had fairly recently become titular organist at the Cathedral of Notre Dame in Paris. And this is the first symphony that he wrote after his appointment to that position. It seems to be demonstrating the massive power of that instrument, so you'll hear some very, very big and assertive music from the very beginning. In actual fact, during Vierne's 37 years at Notre Dame, the instrument was generally in poor shape most of the time. And he undertook, on one occasion, a tour of North America specifically to raise funds for its renovation.
Thank you.
I've been incredibly blessed and fortunate, while in Bozeman, to have had the wonderful friendship and support of Eric Funk. And one of the greatest opportunities he gave me was the opportunity to have an episode of his show 11th and Grant, which if you haven't seen it, is still available on the Montana PBS website to view. A year or so ago, Eric mentioned to me a new piece that he was writing that had started out as a piece for piano three hands, and he was interested in making it work on the organ. And so I was very honored when he dedicated this piece to me, the unremembered central message from six different dreams. We've asked Eric to give a little introduction in his own words to the piece.
It's been said that dreams inform us of ignored, overlooked, or denied aspect of self, and that they can present the underlying archetypal and mythological motifs that direct, pattern, and give meaning to our waking existence. It's been my experience that powerfully strong dreams are often trying to make us conscious of critically important things. Imagine, then, a series of six completely different dreams with a singular purpose: to carry a highly important message into the waking consciousness of the dreamer. The title of this piece is The Unremembered Central Message from Six Different Dreams. That, in a nutshell, is what inspired the creation of this very strange piece you are about to hear. The overall impact of the music you are about to hear should be similar to the experience the dreamer of these dreams would have: a clear memory of the feeling tone of each individual dream, but the inability to remember the important thing that our mind is trying desperately to convey through these failed attempts. I would like to add that one of the inspirations for this piece comes from an actual dream I had some 50 years ago. In the dream, I was in an earlier century walking with a group of men carrying torches, together searching a giant cave system in some urgent haste for some elusive, frightening creature. At some point, I was separated from the group and found myself alone. I entered a massive underground vault, a cathedral cave of sorts, and noticed on the far wall a huge pipe organ emerging from the rock. Some of the pipes were metal pipes and some were stone, stalactites and stalagmites. Some of the organ case was wood and some was rock. It was all fused together. The lighting was otherworldly, amber, and similar to firelight in the way it danced on the surrounding walls. I went to the organ, sat down, and began to play the strangest music. As I went deeper into my own rhapsodic improvised performance, I gradually became aware that the creature was right behind me. An arm came over my shoulder, and a hand joined into the music we were making together. The unremembered central message from six different dreams.
Thank you.
Next, I'm going to play the third movement from Vierne's Second Symphony. And this is a complete contrast to what you heard at the beginning of the concert. It actually seems designed to show that even a huge instrument like the instrument of Notre Dame could be light on its feet. Vierne had a very difficult life, as well as being almost blind. He had a lot of personal tragedies, family members die, his wife left him. On one occasion, he spent a couple of months in a sanatorium in Switzerland in a darkened room. And perhaps as a consequence, he's a composer not best known for his humor, shall we say, but there is, in this piece at least, a real lightness of touch that is really quite striking. When I was learning this piece, I recall saying to my wife, well, I doubt I'll ever play this one in church, because it seemed like it would be suitable really for the prelude of a service, but there was no way I was going to be able to play this many notes in the right order at 8 o'clock in the morning. So there's another reason why I'm really grateful to have this forum and be able to bring this piece out for you.
Thank you.
So a few years ago, I decided I was actually going to set myself the task of trying to play all Bach's organ works in church services. And I worked through them pretty much without repeating. And my intention was always that when I finished, the last one I'd play would be the Passacaglia and Fugue in C minor. Now, unfortunately, because I have to leave town, one of the things that happened is I didn't quite get through all Bach's organ works, but at last count, I was about two-thirds of the way there, so I feel pretty pleased with that. The Passacaglia and Fugue is probably the grandest of them all, and it's certainly my favorite. My first teacher described it as one of the greatest examples of architecture in music. And I think that's a really interesting comment, because one of the things about this piece is that you know where you are in it. It's very, very clear how it's constructed. So you'll hear the Passacaglia theme in the pedals, and then there are 20 variations on that, always on the same theme. And the tension builds, and when the tension gets huge and really can't get any further, we break straight into a fugue, which uses the same theme as the Passacaglia, or the first half of it anyway, but for the first time starts to navigate into different keys, and there's this massive sense of release. So it's a really satisfying, dramatic work. I really wanted the last notes that I play before leaving Bozeman to be these ones. It's a piece which means a lot to me. Hopefully you'll enjoy it as well. It has been such a pleasure to make music with and for so many of you over the past nearly 5 years. I'm going to miss you all massively.